today. Hello, everybody. This is Josh Price, and you are listening to the Mark Price for Three podcast. Each episode, my dad will be talking NBA basketball, sharing some coaching and instruction, and of course, talking about his faith. Without further delay, here's my dad, Mark Price.
Welcome to episode 38 of the Mark Price for Three podcast. Mark, it has been a few weeks since we had a podcast. You've been busy. It's a busy summer for you. And so welcome back.
Well, it's good to be back, Aaron. It has been. It seems like a long time, but it's only been a couple of weeks. But yeah, with holidays and other things going on, it's been a busy summer and continues to be as I got three more camps here coming up in the Cleveland area in the next 3 weeks. So we're still grinding and pumping it out, but glad to be back on the podcast with you this morning.
Well, and we were glad to have you in Hilliard. Gosh, was it last week, Mark? I don't know. Everything's running together.
Was it last week? About 10 days ago. Yeah, we did the camp in Hilliard. It was a fabulous experience. Great turnout, great facility. Got to give you guys in Hilliard props, man. You guys put it on the top shelf. We had a great time and got good feedback too as well. So I think people enjoyed us coming to Hilliard. The camp was a great success and look forward to coming back next year.
Absolutely. We will absolutely have you back. I was at the 4th of July parade, and literally right where we were standing, there was this little guy with a 25 Mark Price camp shirt on. It made me smile.
Love the advertising, right?
It was great. And it was funny because he was standing next to a kid with a Kershaw jersey on and another kid with some other jersey on. And there was 25 right there in the middle of it. Made me happy. So, anyway, all right, man, we got a lot to cover because it's been a while. Free agency is off and running wild at the moment. Trades are happening. So let's start with free agency. What do you think about what the Cavs have done? So they've made, you know, they've re-signed some guys. They've made some significant signings. It looks like to at least upgrade the bench. I don't know that there's a guy that there's not a Donovan Mitchell here, but what are your thoughts on the Cavs and what they've done so far?
Well, I really like the Cavs. You know, I'll let you kind of go down all the moves they made, and I'll kind of comment as you kind of go through. Obviously, the big catch, in my opinion, was Strus.
Right.
He obviously, everybody knows who he is because of his, you know, playoff experience this last year with the Heat. Mm-hmm. I think he's just a solid guy. I mean, he's not a superstar player, but he's going to be very effective, I think, with spacing the floor, giving the Cavs another shooter. And he's a good defender. He's just solid. I really like that pickup a lot. I think that was obviously the coup of the free agency for the Cavs. But they also had some other moves, and I'll let you kind of go down the list with them there.
Sure. I mean, I agree with you, Strus. I think we got to see him, you know, on full display in the NBA Finals. Anybody that comes from the Heat culture, I'm a fan, you know, because right. they know how to grind. They know how to get after it. And I agree with everything you said. And he does spread the floor. And he's an interesting guy because he's just one of those Miami culture guys that was under the radar. You know, nobody's ever heard of this guy. And boom, he goes to Miami, finds a home, he creates, and good for him, like good for him for creating a future opportunity for himself. So agree with you on Strus. Re-signing LeVert.
Yeah, I think that was obviously important to the Cavs organization to keep some semblance of, you know, they had some success last year and LeVert, you know, was part of that in a little bit of up and down kind of situation there. I'd like to see him kind of take it to the next level. I'm sure everybody would with the Cavs organization because you can see the ability there. I mean, there were certain games he looked tremendous, but you didn't quite know who was going to show up, you know. And mm-hmm. So hopefully he can continue to grow. It was nice to see that he wanted to come back to the Cavs. I'm sure he would have had other opportunities, but he liked his situation with the Cavaliers and gives them another guy that has some firepower coming in off the bench.
Columbus guy too. So that makes me happy. He's an Ohio guy. He makes me, you know, now it doesn't make Ohio State fans happy because I think he played at Michigan. So there's always that. But, you know, let me ask you really quick, just as an offshoot, he had a significant injury. And I think we overlooked the fact that he had a significant injury. And prior to that, he was playing at a very high level. How long does it take to come back from an injury?
Well, I think there's the mental side of it.
Exactly.
And there's the physical side. And obviously, physically, he was able to get back out on the court and play. But whenever you've had a significant major injury, To come back from that, there's a mental side of it that you got to get over. And whether or not that was played a part in his inconsistency, I don't know. But, you know, being another summer and another year past that, hopefully he can get over that mental hurdle and just kind of let loose and be the Caris LeVert of old that the Cavs were hoping they were going to get when they brought him in.
Yeah, I agree with you. All right. And I don't know how to say, is it Yang? Is it, how do we say his last name?
Yeah, I'll just follow you on that.
Right. Anyway, they signed another guy. What do you think about that addition? I think it's a good addition off the bench. You know, obviously Kevin Love is gone. Reminds me a lot of Kevin Love. I don't know that he is Kevin Love, certainly not making that comparison, but I think we strengthened the bench there as well.
Yeah, solid player. Has had a decent NBA career so far. Not a super athletic guy, but just understands the game, can shoot the ball, and it gives him another shooter on the floor. He's not really a rebounder like Kevin Love in that sense. He's probably more of a three-ish, you know, probably play a little bit of four type scenario. But just another guy that don't know how many minutes he's going to be in the rotation. You never know till the season comes on, but he's just one of those guys, you know, when you throw him in, he's going to be ready to play. He's one of those veteran guys. That's how he's stayed in the league and made a place for himself, because you know what you're going to get from him when he gets in the game. And it's usually mostly positive things. He's not going to come in and make a lot of mistakes for you. And he's also capable of making some shots.
I think it's a good sign when you're talking about the guys we're talking about right now, that your team is your starting five is set. You're just filling in needs now. And we've talked about needs before on the podcast.
Right.
That's a good sign. That means your team's in a good place, right? If we were talking about, wow, we need a four, we need a five, we need a, you know, that's your team's not probably where they need to be. The Cavs are in a place now where they're looking to fill specific needs. And that's a good place to be, which leads me to the next guy. And I know he's because the game we went to, unfortunately for Cavs fans, I hate to bring it up, but it was the game that Golden State played their entire bench and won. It's not a good day for Cleveland.
Yeah, that was not a good night.
It was a great night because you and I got to enjoy a game from my perspective, but from a fan perspective, from a team perspective, not a good night. But one of the guys that shined that night was Ty Jerome from Virginia. It kills me as an ACC guy, as a UNC guy. It kills me. But Ty Jerome was special that night. What do you think about signing a backup point guard like Ty Jerome?
I think that's, you know, after the Strus, I really like the Jerome pickup. I really like him as a player. It's funny, you know, Bennett at Virginia, he was a big fan of mine over the years. And you know, they really thought Jerome was good. And you watched him and, you know, he doesn't jump out with you with athleticism or things like that. But the kid just knows how to win. I won a championship in college. He knows how to win. He can make shots and he makes plays, and he's just, I think it's a great pickup. And now you got a guy you can trust with the ball in his hands to be your backup point guard, to come in, you know, if Garland needs a breather, or, you know, Donovan in those situations. And so, yeah, I really like that. I really like that pickup. I think he's a good player. And like you said, just strengthen the Cavs bench. And I think the depth now, you look at the Cavs and, you know, now you can put guys in the game and you're not seeing a significant drop off, you know, as maybe they've had in the past couple of years.
Right. I like where they're at. And, you know, who knows? There's still a lot of time left. We're just beginning this process. But let's move really quickly to some of the other trades, non-Cavs related, that have taken place. CP3, Beal to Phoenix Suns. There's a lot of movement happening right now in the NBA with some big name guys. And we continue to see this big three mentality, which I think we've talked about before. Does it work or not? We don't know, but it's still happening. Guys teaming up together. What are your thoughts on some of the big trades that, or at least, you know, trades and signings that have happened so far along the landscape of the NBA?
Yeah, I do like the Phoenix move. I'm a Bradley Beal fan. I think he's a really, really good player. Another guy that can really score the ball. I mean, how do you keep Phoenix from scoring the ball with, you know, Booker, Durant, and now you got Beal with it? Be interesting to see now that they don't have that quote unquote point guard, you know, right. On the roster. It'll be interesting to see how they approach playing with those. Do they put a point guard with them, or do they just take turns letting those guys bring the ball up the floor and, you know, play bigger. There's a lot of options. It'll be interesting to see what direction Phoenix goes with their roster, because it's unique. It wasn't trading a point guard for a point guard type deal. Mm-hmm. But, you know, everybody knows Chris Paul was kind of the quarterback of that team for years. And so it'll be interesting to see. But I think, you know, from Phoenix perspective, with Chris Paul's age and his kind of tendency to get injuries at come playoff time,
right,
I think they just kind of said, well, I think let's move on and let's go a different direction. And picking up a guy like Beal is a pretty nice move.
Yeah, and I think we're still waiting for the Kyrie shoe to fall. Lillard is still out there. There's a lot of rumors around Lillard. Did you see this kind of movement when you were – I don't feel like in the late 80s, early 90s, we had a lot of this kind of movement. Do you think this has gone a little off the – not off the rails, it's just different than it was when you played? I felt like guys stayed with teams a lot longer.
Yeah, they did. I mean, in my era, you know, our core group of guys were together for, you know, 7, 8, 9 years, right, in some cases. And so I think most teams were that way. The star players were at teams for, you know, most of their career, if not, you know, all of it, until possibly maybe the end of their careers. You'd see guys maybe try to hang on and bounce to a couple teams on the back end of their careers. But yeah, in the prime of their careers, I don't think you saw near the movement back when I played that you're seeing now. And like you said, this wanting to have this big three mentality. And I don't know, you kind of saw with Miami and Denver getting in the finals this year that maybe that mindset might change a little bit, but
right,
it doesn't look like it has. I think there's still this, the more superstars we have, the better chance we have to win. And, you know, in some cases, maybe that's true. Others, I'm not so sure. So yeah, I think teams are still kind of trying to figure out the formula, so to speak. And I don't know that there's a formula other than getting the right guys and the right guys that fit together. And I think you saw that this year with two teams. They had teams that fit together and they played well together and they got all the way to the finals.
It'll be interesting to see where Lillard goes. It looks like Miami may be clearing space for him. That's the constant rumor. I think Kyrie might have signed. I can't remember now. But there's just still a lot of movement. And I think there's still movement to happen because everybody's waiting for all these pieces to fall into place. But it does kind of lead to now you're seeing summer league. So I think, what do we call him, Victor? we don't even mess with the last name. Yeah. Victor had a real rough game, that first game. Do you think San Antonio's front office was scrambling after his first game? Because it was not pretty. And he even came out and said, I have no idea what I'm doing right now. That's not exactly what you want to hear from your top pick. But had a good night last night, looks like, you know, filled up the box sheet. What are your thoughts on summer league? Now, you didn't have summer league, right?
No, we did not have summer league back when I was playing. And so, yeah, that's been a recent phenomenon within the last 10, 12 years. You know, it's kind of grown into this summer, you know, kind of all the teams come and hang out and they play their, you know, the rookies and the free agents. And it's kind of this spectacle that it's created there, and trying to, you know, in some ways, I think just trying to keep interest in the league over the summertime, but also it gives teams a time to kind of go watch, because a lot of guys are playing free agents and things like that, right? There's a lot of guys floating around, and every year I think, you know, got some guys get seen that maybe weren't drafted. I mean, you've seen that with the Heat, and their heads pop up in the summer league and they get some interest going. And so it's a great opportunity from a player standpoint, if you haven't been drafted or, you know, you're a free agent kind of guy, to kind of, I mean, every single team with every coach and GM and scouts, I mean, everybody's there. So if there's a place to get seen, it would be at summer league. So it's a great opportunity for a lot of these guys that are, you know, passed over or, you know, under the radar, or with only two rounds, you know, in the NBA now, there's a lot of guys that didn't get drafted. So it used to be, you know, 5-6 rounds. And so it was a different scenario, but now, you know, it's almost like there's this freedom to, hey, I can choose which team I want to go play on, to try to show off my talents to all the coaches and scouts and GMs that are going to be in attendance.
And I don't know how heavy the competition is. I mean, I saw a highlight reel the other night, and I mean, this is no disrespect, but Anthony Bennett, Summer League highlight reel, and he was off the charts amazing, and the guy struggled in the NBA. So I don't know exactly how high level this competition is and how much you can read into it, but I will say a guy like, to your point, Brady Manek, you know, Tar Heel and played at Oklahoma. So we probably both have, you know, there's a guy that played overseas last year, went out for Atlanta the other night and just lit it up. And, you know, the guy's got a space. I think there's got to be a team somewhere that can use this guy that can spread a floor when we're in this era of the NBA. You know, I'd love nothing more than see Brady Manek make a team somewhere, and he's out there doing his thing, you know, and that this is his, it's more his opportunity than the number one pick, I think, is what we're trying to say, right?
Oh yeah, no doubt. I mean, the number one picks there, you know, the coaches and teams, they're watching those guys, but it's, everybody knows it's a process. I mean, literally, I mean, I was a head coach for the Orlando Summer League team 1 year, and you literally have like 3 days. It's right. Like they bring a group of guys in, you got 3 days that, okay, let's go play. And so, you know, I mean, there's not a whole lot that you can do. It's not like you can put in all these different schemes and and different things. In a lot of ways, you're kind of just rolling the ball, and it's a little bit of glorified pickup ball to a certain extent, but it allows, some guys can thrive in that environment, and other guys need more structure, and they probably are going to struggle a little bit in that environment because guys are out there for themselves in a lot of ways, right? They're trying to make a roster. They're trying to get seen. So 4 or 5 passes on the offensive end probably didn't happen a lot in summer league.
Exactly.
Because guys aren't interested in swinging the ball.
Right. Yeah. You're not looking for one more pass. You're looking, I saw the other night Bates pulled up from, if he took that shot in a game, he'd probably get pulled, but he's out there getting, you know, he's showing the Cavs fans. So that's the thing for Cavs fans. Don't read too much into this summer league stuff, regardless of how Bates does. Let's see how he does when he's in camp and he's in a system and he's with around guys. I did see that he's very happy to be with the team and kind of re-energized to be in the NBA. So hopefully that's good for the Cavs. Ultimately, I think it comes down to, as you said, guys getting an opportunity that are not number one picks, number two picks. Number two, it's good for the NBA, which makes them a lot of money, which leads me to the next and last point in this segment, and that is the in-season tournament. What are your thoughts on the in-season tournament? I don't understand it. I can only relate it to, as best I understood it so far, is pool play, which are in-season games, which actually count as in-season games. And then that goes, and then it goes to some other levels, and ultimately they're going to give a title to somebody in December after some single elimination stuff. I don't know. I still don't quite understand it, but what are your thoughts about the NBA implementing a tournament in the season?
Yeah, it's a little strange just from my perspective. There's got to be a reason they're trying to do it, which I think on most people's minds is try to help with, you know, draw more interest to the league. Right. I think anytime a change is made, there's the purpose ultimately is let's try to get more clicks and more people to watch the league. And if this somehow kind of like the play-in game with the playoffs, try to get more teams involved in quote unquote kind of playoff, you know, intensity, it gives the fan base, oh, look, we're in the play-in championship here in December. Yeah, maybe that brings some excitement to the fan base and whichever teams are doing well in it. But overall, it's just as a player, I look at it and I'm thinking, okay, so I'm already playing preseason games. I'm already playing 82 regular season games, which now most guys only play 60 of those. Right. It seems like. So to me, now you're going to play a play-in game. It'll be interesting to see right after the play-in stuff, how many guys sit out for regular season games because they're tired or they're, you know, whatever is minutes, watching their minutes and all the different things that are going on now. So it just throws another kind of strange situation in my opinion of kind of, or are you going to play your best player if they're injured a little bit? Are you even going to play them in the play-in games or in the play-in tournament or whatever they're calling it in the middle of the season? So yeah, I think the first year for sure is just going to be kind of a sit back and wait kind of scenario because it's never been done. I don't know how much excitement from the player side of things this brings, but I mean, what do you do? You're going to get some kind of trophy handed to you for midseason championship. And then, I mean, I don't, you know, yeah. it's, On the backside, you're just kind of like, what's the end game? But ultimately, the end game is trying to create more excitement for the NBA among the fan base.
I look at it that there was guys sitting around a conference room, and there was this list, and this, I don't know if this happened, but there's this list of issues or things that are affecting the NBA. And they said, okay, what can we come up with to fix it? Revenue, viewership. And then they're looking across the board at NCAA tournament and its popularity. And I think they came up with this idea. Oh, the other thing is load management, which we have and have not talked about in the past. You mentioned it earlier. Guys aren't playing. It's the middle of, you know, it's the second, third month of the season. Guys are taking days off. This is kind of how I see it. How do we fix that? Well, let's put this tournament in where every game matters now. It's not just some game against Cleveland in the middle of December or November. It matters. And then let's put this tournament in single elimination. There you pull in this NCAA tournament, kind of you're in and you're out. You get brackets. I'm sure, you know, whether we like it or not, betting is involved, I'm sure. Anyway, I think all that kind of came together in this thing that they're going to roll out, and we'll see how it goes.
I guess my biggest question is, in the minds of the player, I mean, does it really matter? I mean, it's, you know, it's, I mean, you're saying, okay, well, there's a tournament, maybe it matters. I don't know. Maybe it does. Maybe it doesn't.
Right.
We'll see, you know, I mean, we'll see how fired up guys get. I mean, are guys going to dive for that loose ball and to win the in-season tournament and, you know, blow a knee out? And then I don't know. There's an opportunity for some interesting scenarios coming out of it. Let's put it that way.
Well, give us more for the podcast, I'm sure, coming next season. So let's transition. You, in your playing days, a lot of this stuff, as we've said, didn't happen when you were playing. There's all these different factors. There's, you know, there was free agency, obviously there was trades, and we've already talked a little bit about that, about teams staying together. I know you've talked on previous episodes about being traded from the Cavs and the rest of your journey, free agency, trades, all that kind of stuff. What goes through the player's mind at this time of year? And it's hard probably to know what these guys are thinking today, but in your time, when you played, what goes through your mind in these off seasons?
Yeah, I think obviously at different stages of your career. I mean, when I was in the midst of my career with Cleveland, I used my summers to get myself ready for the next season. I mean, I knew I was going to be with the Cavs. I knew what to prepare for and, you know, get myself healthy, trying to get, you know, stronger, whatever, work on my game to add some things to it every year. All those different scenarios, it was pretty stressless, so to speak, because right. you knew where you were and you were comfortable there. Now, you know, these guys, and there's even a lot of guys back in my era that, you know, kind of 1 year contract guys going from year to year. They didn't know necessarily where they were going to be from 1 year to the next and trying to survive and stay in the league. And that's a whole different, you know, mindset. And, you know, obviously having an agent that's working for you to try to find a spot for you and getting teams interested in you and those kind of situations for those type of guys. But yeah, it's, I mean, I look at a guy there and it got some newsworthy and I love him because he was on some of the teams that I coached. Ish Smith, you know, got a ring. He was on the Denver Nuggets this year. And that, I believe it was his 13th or 14th wow. team. You know, he's basically been on a different team about every single year of his NBA career. And yet he's been able to find a way to be that 13th guy, that 14th guy. And, you know, that's not the sexy like approach or the, you know, hey, everybody wants to be on ESPN and everybody wants to get all the, but the guy's made a good living for himself. He's found a way to be that guy, mm-hmm. knowing that he's not going to play most nights, right. but yet has found a way to be a valuable member of a team that other teams, when they get down to, all right, we got one spot left. What guy do we want?
Yeah.
And so typically you're looking for a high character guy, a guy that's going to be about the team. You certainly don't want to bring a troublemaker in that's going to be in those positions. And so, you know, kudos to Ish. I was so happy for him. He's a great, great young man and has a great attitude. And that's why teams want him, you know, in those spots on their team, because he's going to be talking to the players in positive ways and, you know, lifting him up. And then, oh, by the way, guy went down. He's not playing tonight. Ish, you're playing. And he goes in and he always performs well. Mm-hmm. And I mean, what can you not love about a guy like that? So those kind of guys can make a career for themselves. And that's the opposite. You don't talk about those guys a lot. Right. I mean, you talk about the superstars and the guys doing this and that. But there are those guys that have made a career for themselves in the league with not a lot of fanfare. And yet they've created, you know, a position for themselves that's valuable. And teams need those kind of guys on their roster.
It's a perfect segue to our faith segment today. And you and I were talking about it. And I want to look at Joseph today from Genesis 37, 1 through 50, 26. And I included that because my favorite verse in the Bible is Genesis 50, 20. It's not one of everybody's favorite. It's mine. It's because it's very personal for me. But let's talk about Joseph for a minute, because I think it folds in very well to what you just said. Here was a guy that, you know, he's one of 12 sons, but he was his dad's favorite. According to scripture, he was his dad's favorite. And I know none of us like to pick our favorite. I mean, I have a friend that says everybody has one. I disagree with her completely. But, you know, he was one of many sons. He was his dad's favorite, according to scripture. His brothers released him, basically were jealous of him, got rid of him, you know. And as we're talking about these transitions in the NBA, they basically got rid of him. Ish won a ring, but Joseph did some amazing things as well. What are your thoughts about that?
Well, it's just an incredible story, you know, when you really read it. And I mean, here are these guys, brothers actually, you know, sold off their brother, mm-hmm. you know, into slavery. And, you know, not to, you know, drag on the story long, but ultimately God uses all that and all the things that Joseph, you know, did as, you know, a servant and all those things to eventually kind of be in charge of making decisions that his brothers would eventually have to come before him.
That's right.
And just the whole gamut of, I'm sure, just hurt from what your brothers did to you to being able to forgive them.
Right.
And to get past those kind of situations and to be able to do God's will. And God was obviously dictating Joseph's life and allowed him to go through those things to prepare him, to put him in a position of power, to be a wise, you know, not only a wise leader, but a leader that could have compassion for others because of what he had gone through in his own life. Mm. And so just an amazing, amazing story from, you know, you hate to call it a rags to riches kind of kind of deal, but I mean, because it's a lot more in depth than that, but an amazing, you know, one amazing where God can take you if, mm-hmm. if your heart is really in tune with him and you trust him, he can pull you out of any situation and he can also put you in situations because he has a plan and a purpose for you. But yeah, it was just an incredible, incredible story of just, you know, having your family turn on you and eventually being someone that saves their family and saves your country, you know. Mm-hmm. And so it's amazing, amazing story.
Especially in the bloodline and the role that he plays within the bloodline of, you know, scripture itself. And again, my favorite verse is, you intended to harm me, but God intended it all for good. He brought me into this position so I could save the lives of many people. And I think about that when things happen in my life, when I get frustrated or I feel like maybe I've been wronged, even if that's true. You know, here's a guy that said, you intended to harm me, but God intended it for good. And I try to remember the second part of that and not this bitter, you intended to harm me. I try to remember that God intended it for good. And what is happening, you know, that, again, the next sentence, what's happening now, the saving of many lives, the impact on other lives. I think that's why it's one of my favorite verses. And it's kind of tucked in Genesis where we don't spend a lot of time, right, you know, right. Love the story. Genesis 37, 1 through 50. If you get a chance, take some time and really think about that. So another good episode today, Mark. It's good to be back with you again. It really is. It's been a while.
It has been. It is good to be back. And, you know, it's just so much fun to watch all the things going on, but you know, it's also just a reminder, like you said, a reminder for what God has for us and that he does have a plan for our lives. And, you know, I know all these guys that are going through all this craziness of free agency and all the things we talk about here and there. But I just always remember, you know, my life when I was going through all those situations, that if you put your trust in the Lord and know that He has a plan for you, then, you know, you can have that peace, that perfect peace that He talks about, and that we can rest on that and know that through good or through bad situations or difficult situations that we might go through, He's going to be there and He's going to be our peace. And that's what I hold on to every day.
That's right. Absolutely. And that's why you are many people are fans of yours, because I think they know that about you, and I know that about you. And so thank you for your faith and your continued just testimony in your life. You know what I mean? It's just the way you live, all those things. So where are we this week, basketball camp wise?
Well, we are in Avon Lake coming up on Wednesday. That was our kind of first camp we did last year, and it's going to be a blowout this year. I mean, those guys, they're going to be rocking, to have well over 100 kids there at that camp this week. So that's going to be a lot of fun. Then we'll be going to Medina and then Canton to wrap it up this summer. So excited about the next 3 weeks. Going to have a lot of opportunity to get in front of a lot of kids and encourage them with their basketball and in life, and looking forward to it.
Well, that sounds good. We will be back next week for episode 39, and then episode 40, maybe a special episode. We have to see where all that goes, because we've got some things in the works, but episode 40 will be a special, and we've got some guests that we're talking to. I'll just leave it at that. We'll leave out that teaser, the cliffhanger. So have a great week this week in Avon Lake, and we'll see you next week, Mark.
All right, Aaron. Always great to talk to you.
Thank you for listening to another episode of the Mark Price for Three podcast. Remember to subscribe, like, review, and share. I'm Josh Price, and we will talk to you again on the next episode.